Alrighty, this is Sunday, April 3rd, 2016, and this is Donni Betts being interviewed by Karen Larson. So thank you very much. It's an honor to get to spend some time with you and learn about you.
Me too. It's my honor.
Awesome. Well, give us a little background about where you were born and what that was like.
Well, I was born November 10th, 1948 in Wichita, Kansas at Wesley Hospital. That's the same hospital where my mom was born, my dad was born, all my aunts and uncles and their spouses were born in Wichita too.
Oh wow. And your brother was born there?
Nope. Oh. He was born in Canada.
Oh wow. So what was the story from Wichita to Canada?
My dad was in the oil business. He was a geologist. And when I was two, we moved to Calgary. And we lived there for 3 years, and he was born during that time. And he's very proud of being a dual citizen. And then when I was almost six, during that time, we moved to San Francisco and lived in San Francisco. And that's an incredibly interesting story. My dad worked for Bishop Oil Company, and at that time he was vice president. And the man who owned the company was William Wallace Mead, and he owned a property that he had bought in. He was from Scotland. He had worked in South Africa, not in the gold mines, but he owned gold mines in South Africa. And while he was in Johannesburg, he fell in love with a mansion. And he said, someday I'm going to own that mansion. And then he moved to Canada, to Toronto, I believe it was, and he became rich in, he started Calaveras Cement Company, and he became very, very wealthy. And then he moved to San Francisco, and he found the most beautiful property on the highest hill overlooking the Golden Gate Bridge in San Francisco, and he bought the property. Then he went back to Johannesburg, South Africa. He bought the mansion that he'd fallen in love with, had it dismantled brick by brick,
oh my,
and shipped to San Francisco and reassembled on Broadway and Divisadero Street. And it's still there. During World War II, it served as the Russian embassy. And this is a great story. So we lived there when I was three.
In that mansion?
In that mansion.
Oh my gosh.
Yes. And it had a little button on the floor under the dining room table that you could call to summon the butler.
Ah!
And I loved to push that button, and the butler would come running.
And how old were you?
Three.
Oh, fun.
Yes.
Oh, fun.
And we've gone back many times, and it's gone through many different transformations. It's even been apartments at one time. And last year, George and I were in San Francisco, and I summoned the courage to ring the doorbell, and the lady answered, and I quickly told her my story, and she said, well, just a minute and I'll come down and meet you. And she did, and she invited us in the house, and that's the first time I've been back in that house since I was three years old.
Did you remember?
Oh my yes.
It hadn't changed enough that you could remember.
No.
Oh my gosh. And when did you leave San Francisco?
We went back to Canada then.
And how long did you live there?
For 3 years. And then we moved back to Wichita. And then when I was 10, and while we were in Wichita, I went to three different elementary schools in first grade. And
why was that?
I don't remember, but I just remember that we did.
Did you move?
Yep.
Oh, you moved three times in first grade. Wow.
Yep.
So do you think all this has contributed to your love of travel?
What really contributed to my love of travel was that we traveled so much when I was young. We went to every state west of the Mississippi and western Canada too, and Alaska and Europe. So
for vacations?
Yeah.
And was that your mom or your dad that loved to travel so much?
My dad, I think.
So when you were seven, you took a pretty awesome trip.
We did. We lived in Wichita. My brother was two, so he stayed with my grandmother, and we took a 6-week trip to Alaska. This was 1953, so the Alcan Highway wasn't paved. And my dad had a steel plate welded to the underside of our car so that
the rocks,
rocks wouldn't puncture it. And he had 8 tires strapped to the top of the car, and then we went through all 12 tires.
Oh my God.
This was an 11,000 mile journey. And we traveled from Wichita to Fairbanks and then to Nome. And we traveled, of course, through, up through Canada. And it was pretty rough, pretty rough. We fished on glaciers, and I can remember my parents scrubbing these iron pots with snow or ice from the glaciers to get the pots clean. And we lived on fish and peanut butter, and my mom had pickles because she loved pickles, and Vienna sausages and beans, and that was mostly what we ate.
Well, yeah, not exactly a grocery store there.
No, and there weren't many hotels when we got far up into Alaska because it was still such frontier country. So we'd sleep in the car. My dad would sleep in the front seat because it was bench seats. My mom would sleep in the back seat, and I would sleep on the floor. They put pillows down on the floor because there was that big hump on the floor. And that's how we'd sleep.
And your brother was on the floor too?
He stayed with Grandma.
Oh, because he was too little.
Yeah.
Wow, yeah. What an adventure.
It was an adventure.
Wow, so whose idea was it to go to Alaska?
Oh, my dad's. He was the adventurer. And one time while he was fishing, he went down this bank and he dropped his tackle box, and he went back for it, and there was a grizzly bear. And so he came running up the bank, and my mom opened the car door, and he dove in.
And the bear was chasing him?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my.
Yes.
And it didn't go to your car and try to get it?
Oh, yeah, it tried to, but she drove off and
oh my
got away from it.
Oh,
and we
and lived to tell the tale.
Yep. And we went panning for gold, and we flew across the Arctic Circle to Kotzebue. And I can remember that it was summer, so it was light until midnight, and my parents were out, and I was alone in the hotel room. It was,
yeah,
you know, back then.
And right.
I was trying to go to sleep, but it was light outside, and this Kotzebue is still a famous town, and I remember they said that 1/3 of the people had TB, but I heard TV, and I thought, well, I don't see any TV around. And we just walked through the streets, and we were going to go on a whale-watching trip out into the sea, into the Bering Sea, but the ice flow was so great that we weren't able to do that. And then we went, but we did see a blanket toss. It was, you know, a real native event, and we met some people named Terry and Barry Shank that my friends became lifelong friends with on this trip. And then we went to Nome, I had such vivid memories of that trip. It was a life-changing trip for all of us.
That was awesome.
Really incredible. 11,000 miles.
And how long? How many weeks?
6 weeks. And we had to wear gas masks at one point because the dust was so bad. But my dad had...
He thought to pack that? Awesome. So what were the dates again of the trip?
It was in 1953, the summer of 53. It was probably June and July, I'm guessing.
Oh, wow. What an adventure.
Yeah. And I remember we were in a cafe in, I can't remember the town, but we heard on the radio in the cafe that President Eisenhower had a heart attack. It's one of my strong memories.
Wow.
I wish I could remember all these towns, and I remember that one time my dad went fishing, we went fishing with some people, and my dad caught a trout that was like that. Just amazing. We still have the photos.
Oh, wow.
Some of the slides of all this.
Wow. Wow. Something you couldn't do today like that.
No.
That's pretty amazing. Did you have any other memories you wanted to share?
When I was 18, we took a trip to Europe. It was the first time we'd ever gone to Europe, and it was a 3-week adventure, and that's when I fell in love with Europe. We landed in Amsterdam. My brother was a little poop. He was 13, and he wasn't into that, but we landed in Amsterdam. We went to Germany, and we stayed in an incredible palace in Königswinter. We went to Switzerland and Austria and Liechtenstein and then to London.
What year was this?
1967. And also France. We spent one night in France.
Wow.
And I was bitten by the bug.
Big time.
Yep.
Awesome. Cool.
And then when I was 10, we moved back to Calgary for another almost 3 years. And then back to San Francisco area, and then back to Wichita, and then when I graduated from high school, we moved to the Denver area.
Oh, wow.
So,
wow.
Got this travel bug in my blood.
I think so. By experience and by genetics, huh? That's cool. Now, I love your name, Donni. It's a gorgeous name. I don't think I even know your middle name, so can you tell me the origins of your name?
Sure. My dad was Don. And my mom was Jean, so I was Donna Jean, but they always called me Donni.
Cute. And you never wanted to go by Donna?
Never did. No.
Nice. Alrighty. Well, what did you enjoy doing as a child? What were your hobbies and pastimes?
I was a passionate reader, and I liked writing. I liked writing stories and poems. I really got into mysteries, and I liked writing mysteries.
Nancy Drew, was she part of your life?
Yes, I introduced Ainsley to Nancy Drew when she was really little, and we read them together.
Five.
Yes.
Were you outside girl or inside girl?
Both. I ice skated in Canada.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Oh, neat. Did you compete?
No. No, just on a local pond that froze over in the winter. Just hiking and fishing. And
That's awesome. Did you like to do any crafts? Art? Anything with music? Anything there?
I played the organ, but I wasn't very good at it. So. No, I don't think I was very crafty.
Not drawn to that?
No.
Awesome. Okay. Yeah. Tell me about you and your brother. Did you play a lot together?
Oh, we did. We were so close because we were all we had to count on when we moved. We just were very close.
And what's his full name?
Mark Iliff Lawless.
And how
Iliff is a family name.
And which side?
My dad's. It's my dad's middle name, and it was his dad's name.
Oh, neat. So it's always passed down. And Jordy is not that name? Or?
No. His middle name's Thomas,
okay.
After George.
Oh, okay, cool. So as you were growing up, who was your most influential person?
It's hard to say between my mom and my dad. They both were, I'd say, equally influential. My mom was a homemaker, but she always had a dream of becoming a nurse. And my parents had a dream that she would put him through college when they first were married. And so she worked and he went to school. He'd been in the military. He'd been in the Army Air Corps and was a fighter pilot in World War II. And he flew P-47s. He flew 101 fighter missions. And so when he came home after the war, he wanted to finish college. So she worked to pay for his college, and the deal was that whenever she wanted to go to college, he would pay for that because he was working. And so when I graduated from high school and went to college, she decided she'd go back to school and get her nursing degree.
Oh, wow.
And she did that.
And she did it? And did she work as a nurse?
She did. She worked at St. Anthony's hospital.
What kind of nursing did she do?
On a surgical floor.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So did she assist in surgery, or was she aftercare?
No, she took aftercare.
Okay.
Yeah. And then she worked at Frontier Airlines as a nurse.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow. What were the time frames of those? Years?
Gosh. That would have been 66 that she went to school.
Uh-huh.
And so the 70s, early 70s, I'd say.
That's really interesting.
And George and I got free, or almost free trips on Frontier, wherever they flew. And
oh, wow.
So we did a lot of flying around.
Ties into all that travel.
Yeah.
Passion, there you go. If you had three words to describe your parents, what would you use?
Fun. Passionate. Describe my dad as, well, oh no, let me start over, because I want to describe him each individually.
Okay.
My mom, kind, fun, and passionate.
Uh-huh.
My dad, intense, brilliant, and diverse in his activities, I guess. That's not a word, but...
Who do you identify with the most?
Probably him. Yeah. Him.
And why is that?
Because I always admired his intellect and his... He's a genius. A true genius.
Mm-hmm.
And his interests, his hobbies, he was brilliant in every aspect. He was a fabulous pianist. He was a fabulous artist. He was interested in geology, astronomy. I'm forgetting things, but I think he set an example with his passions.
And lifelong learning.
Yes.
Neat.
Yeah.
How are you as a student, both socially and academically?
I was extremely shy. And I think part of that was a result of always being the new kid and never sure if I was going to be accepted. And sometimes I was accepted and sometimes I was not accepted. That was really hard. As a student, I can remember one time, one place we moved in Canada, and they had the kids set up in rows, and in the left-hand row were the gifted kids. And I remember thinking, I needed to be in that row, but there was no way that a newcomer could break in to that row, and that was really hard for me. I was a good student, but I didn't apply myself very much because I didn't need to.
What were your favorite subjects?
English and foreign languages.
Where did you go to school? What were your elementary? What was your main elementary, your main middle, junior high at the time in high school?
I went to McLean Elementary School from second grade to middle of fifth grade in Wichita.
Uh-huh.
That was a brand new elementary school. We were so proud of it. And that's probably the school I identify most with as an elementary school. But then we moved to Calgary and I went to, I think, three more elementary schools. And then junior high school there.
Cool.
And then two more in California, and then I settled down for the rest of my school career in Wichita. And then I went to North High School in Wichita, which is also where all my parents and all my aunts and uncles went. So I had some continuity with that, which was nice.
Cool. Were you in any clubs or sports or extracurricular activities?
Yeah, I was in French Club.
Ah!
I was
no
the vice president. And our pep club, which We had a really unusual high school. It was a big high school, but it wasn't cliquey.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a huge group of girls that were friends. And I mean, we'd have slumber parties with 50, 60
girls. Oh my goodness.
And
that poor mom did not hit her that night, huh?
I know. And there were a bunch of boys that were friends with these girls, and there weren't huge romances. It was so healthy.
Nice.
And then I also played volleyball. That was my sport.
What position did you like the best in volleyball?
Forward.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. I was little, but...
Did you let her?
No.
I mean, it was different for girls then, huh? We could hardly get a letter. Was there a teacher that particularly influenced you?
There were two. The French teacher.
What was her name?
Mrs. Beindorf.
Not Madame?
No. She was just precious and petite and passionate, and she went to France, and... I regret I only took 2 years of French in high school, and then I thought the verbs were getting too complicated, and which I now know they really weren't.
Yeah.
Then I switched to Spanish, but in a way I don't regret that because we moved to Spain and I was able to speak Spanish. So.
When did you move to Spain?
Oh, when George and I were
married. Okay.
That's it.
Yeah, that helps.
And then our journalism teacher because... I was really passionate about that, too. So
tell me about a time you were ornery growing up, other than the butler button pushing.
I wasn't a very ornery kid, but I could really give it to my brother. But he was really ornery, so oh, yeah. He deserved it.
That's funny. What would people find surprising about you as a teen?
As a teen?
Uh-huh.
Oh, okay. Ainsley, Lauren, and Haley, close your ears. I really like to drive. And I was a really good driver. I am a really good driver.
Uh-huh.
And my parents had... two cars. They had a 1966 Mustang, but just three on the floor.
Uh-huh.
But I was good at it. And then, I'll tell you two stories. And then they also had a 66 white Impala 396 Super Sport. And I used to take that Mustang out on the country roads outside of Wichita and race the boys. Which was hard to do with the three on the floor because it wasn't a really powerful car.
So was somebody there with the flag and the whole bit?
Nope. Oh. We just race. I do pretty well.
And did you win?
Sometimes.
Sure. That's great.
And then I wasn't allowed to take that Impala out because that was my dad's car.
Yeah.
But one day, it was a Sunday and my parents were at the movies and I thought, this is my chance, I'm going to take it. So I did, and it rained.
Oh, gosh.
So there were tire tracks leading back into the garage, and I got caught, and I got the only time I got grounded.
Bueller? That is great. That is great. So did you have jobs in high school or after high school?
Right after high school, I got a... My dad said, you need a job, and he went and found this job for me at the Quick Shop, which is, I was worked the cash register, sort of like a 7-Eleven.
Uh-huh.
And at first, I wasn't very happy, but I liked it. Uh-huh. And I did a lot of babysitting.
Uh-huh. What was the best job you ever had?
I worked at a bank, downtown Denver.
Uh-huh. Which bank?
U.S. Bank. Yeah.
Were you a teller? Or?
No, I worked in the mortgage department.
Oh, cool.
I learned a lot.
That's really cool.
Yeah.
So did you go to high school right after? I mean, college right after high school?
Yes, we moved the summer after I graduated from high school, and I felt just ripped apart to have to move from my friends. Mm-hmm. But I think it was kind of a natural time to move to. We moved to Denver, to Lakewood.
And what brought you all to Denver?
My dad's job.
And who was he working for here in Denver?
He worked for NCRA, which was National Cooperative Refinery Association. And he was vice president in charge of exploration and development. He worked in the oil business all his life. And it was quite a job. That was a Fortune 500 company. And he actually decided he liked Denver so much he wanted to move the company, that part of the company here. So I decided to go to CSU. And
you moved to Lakewood, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember your address?
11476 West 26th Place.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Cool. So you went to CSU. Did you live in the dorms?
I did. I lived in Ellis the first year and in Parmalee the second year.
And did you make good friends with your roommates, or do you have still relationships with them? Or?
No.
Hmm.
No.
And what did you major in?
I had three majors.
Oh, wow.
First, I majored in English, and then that decided that wasn't for me, so I majored for probably a week in sociology, and then I changed to psychology, and that's what I graduated in.
Then undergrad, and what did you want to do with that?
I had no idea. I just liked the classes.
That's great. Is there a memory from college that stands out for you?
I'd rather not talk about it. Yeah, I got. I went to CSU for 3 years, and then I switched to UNC.
And why did you do that?
I had two friends who were killed in car accidents, and it was really painful, and so I decided to change colleges. And so I came here, and I had a roommate named Shirley, and she'd taken a psychology class, and she kept talking about this dang George Betts. She had, her boyfriend had him for a professor, and her boyfriend started to change and grow, and she didn't like the results.
Oh no.
Then I had to take the same class, so I thought, well, I'll find out who this dang George Betts is.
And what was the class?
It was group process and human dynamics. And so I walked into the class, and the chairs were all in a circle, and there were a couple people sitting there, and I kept waiting for the professor to come in, and finally this young guy stood up, and I thought, well, that's George Betts, that young kid. Huh? So that's how I met my husband.
Oh, funny. And how old were each of you?
I was 22 and he was 26.
Oh, wow. Wow. And was there an instant attraction? Or did it grow over time?
I think on his part there was. And I mean, he had a girlfriend, though, and I was dating all the boys in the class.
How fun. Did you like the class?
Oh, I loved the class. I thought it was just an innovation. Yeah.
That's fun. So when did you move from student teacher to something more?
After the class. Right after the class. He invited me to go to San Francisco for spring break with him and two other girls to visit some friends out there of his. So.
And was that as friends or?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
And the girlfriend was no longer at that point?
Right. After we got back from the trip. She was just a friend by then. And he asked me if I would go, if we could take my car, because I had a cool car. I had a Carmen Ghia, red Carmen Ghia.
Oh my goodness, you did have a cool car.
Yeah.
Holy smokes. If you could do it over again, would you take a different academic path?
I don't think I would. I really treasure that. Yeah, I might change that though. I think if I could do it over again, I might have stayed with the French in high school and pursued that.
And would you want to teach French or be an interpreter, or what would you want to do with that degree?
If I could take George out of the equation, I probably would have pursued living in France and being an interpreter.
Cool.
But I can't change it because that's how I met him.
Right, so. Right. Right. So what do you like to do in your free time now?
Can I go
back?
You're
done with school, yeah.
Okay, so I will answer your question. But so after George graduated from college and I graduated from college, I said I have three goals. I said the first is to graduate from college, the second is to go and live in Europe, and the third is to get married. And he had never really been much of anywhere before. He'd been to Oklahoma, we'd been to California, and he'd been to Oregon and Idaho. And so he kind of freaked out at the idea of
going to Europe.
And we got married. So then the next thing was to go live in Europe. So we did that. And
where did you live in Europe?
Well, we sold everything we owned, everything, our cars, our furniture, everything.
He must have really loved you to take a huge risk like that.
I think he did. I think so. And we had two backpacks that my parents had given us for Christmas. And on September 1st of 1972, we had one-way tickets to Paris. It cost $110.
Oh my goodness.
And we had $5,000 saved up from just our savings and my working. And so we landed in Paris and we had no direction. No idea of what we were going to do.
And what did you do?
Well, we had the name of a gal who was the sister of one of George's students. And her husband was an Air Force pilot in Ramstein, Germany. So George called her and we ended up staying with them for a couple of weeks. And they got us connected with different job possibilities through the military support system.
Uh-huh.
And George had taken his diploma, his doctoral diploma with him in baggies.
Oh gosh.
With the idea that he could maybe teach over there. So
what jobs did you all do?
Well, I didn't. I was offered some jobs, but he got a job teaching for the U.S. military through the University of Maryland overseas. And we first taught in, or he did, I say we, but because everything we do is kind of a we.
Yeah, yeah.
But in Karlsruhe, Germany. And we lived in bachelor officers' quarters.
Oh, wow.
With all kinds of cockroaches.
Ew.
And then we were sent to Morón Air Force Base, which is just outside of Sevilla, Spain. And then we were sent, which was dreamy, really dreamy. And then we were sent to Mons, Belgium. And he taught at SHAPE, which is Supreme Headquarters for Allied Powers in Europe, and we lived there. And
did you take a lot of side trips though?
Oh, we traveled all over the place. And then my parents came to visit, and they took us to Paris, and they took us to London, and then we went to Bruges, Belgium, and we had fantastic trips with them.
So they were supportive of you selling your whole life and leaving them?
Yes.
Oh, good.
They just couldn't wait to come visit.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, they brought me up that way.
Yeah, yeah,
so
that's true.
So to them it made total sense.
Total sense.
And they'd taken us to Europe when my brother and I were kids. And
so you were living the dream.
Yep.
And then why did you decide to come back?
Oh, you know, that was a lot of culture shock, and I think we regret it now because the next year we were offered jobs in Italy, Greece, Turkey, Ethiopia, and Spain.
Oh my goodness.
But that's just what we did.
So it was a full year that you stayed overseas?
Almost.
And then got another plane back to Colorado. And then what did you do?
George got a job teaching in Jefferson County at Arvada West High School.
Awesome. So, and what did you do at that point?
I was a pretend teacher.
And then the kids came along, huh?
And then the kids came along.
Little cute ones. So tell us about the kids.
Well, they're the joy of our life. Christy was born in 1976. And then Jordy was born in 1979.
And why don't you say their birth dates?
Christy was February 24th, and she was by C-section. And then Jordy was February 20th, and he was scheduled C-section. So we picked his birthday. And Christy used to get so mad and say, well, if I'm older, why is his birthday first?
Oh, how cute. How cute.
But we chose his birthday so that wouldn't have the same birthday.
How do you tell your story of Charles Eagle Plume? Oh, wait, do you have another card? That card should be, that's your big heavy duty card, right?
It's recording now.
Okay. So why don't you tell us about the kids?
Okay.
Their birth dates and all that.
Well, the kids are the joy of our lives. Christy was born February 24, 1976. She was a scheduled not a scheduled C-section. She was a surprise C-section.
What happened?
She was a breech.
Mm. And they didn't know till you went in?
No. And then Jordy was born February 20th, 1979. So he was a scheduled C-section.
And you had a famous obstetrician.
Yes, Dr. Robert Bradley. And it's ironic because when we lived in Belgium, I prowled the library on the base, and I ran across his book one night when I was there, and I read his book. And
Bradley Method.
The Bradley Method.
Uh-huh.
And I had no idea that one day I would
have need the Bradley Method.
So he was my doctor when I had Christy, and it was amazing because when he performed the C-section, he said, this is the first one I've performed in over a year. I never do C-sections, so we knew we really needed one.
Right.
And then Jordy was, at that time, they always scheduled a C-section after mm-hmm. he had one, so we scheduled his for 4 days before Christy's birthday, so they wouldn't have the same birthday. But she was always frustrated. She said, why, if I'm older, does he have his birthday first?
Poor baby.
I know.
That's so cute. When was he due?
The 19th.
Oh, okay. So
we waited one day past his birthday, due date.
How are your pregnancies with each of them? Were you sick at all?
Or? I was totally sick. I was so sick.
The whole time?
No, just the 3 months.
The 3 months, uh-huh.
Yeah.
And then you felt better?
Yep.
I just remember you being as amazingly beautiful as could be. Just, you were that gorgeous pregnant woman.
Oh.
So beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. How did having them join the family change your life?
Well, when we brought Christy home from the hospital, I thought, what have we done? But that changed immediately. It was just sheer joy. And I have to say, those two kids never fit the mold of teenagers, of the horror stories of teenagers. They were a sheer delight always. Just precious. They were just precious teenagers. They've always been.
And you had been foretold you'd have a girl with Charles Eagleplume, right? Wasn't that the story?
No. The Charles Eagleplume story. No. Actually, it was George who knew that we were going to have a girl. He was meditating under a tree, and he saw a little girl.
Oh.
And he knew that her name was Christina Lynn. And that's...
And you hadn't talked about that?
No.
Wow.
No.
So why don't you tell the Charles Eagleplume story?
We were on our honeymoon, and we got married in Estes Park at Ye Old Church Shops of the Rockies. And then we stayed in a teepee that actually had been made by hand by that old girlfriend of George's, who remained our friend. And she lived in the teepee, but for our honeymoon, she said, well, you can stay in my teepee.
Oh, wow.
So we did, until it rained and we froze, and then we moved into a lodge or a cabin.
Uh-huh.
But we visited Charles Eagleplume, and he gave me a, I can't remember what he gave me. Do you remember what he gave me?
A feather, wasn't it?
I think it was a feather.
Uh-huh.
And he said, I can tell that you are a woman who hasn't lost her femininity either. Most women today have lost their femininity, but you are different. And that's always been something I treasure.
And I thought he gave you a picture to put over your child's crib.
Oh, yes, you're right. That's right. A picture.
I was connecting them to the baby.
Your first child's crib when she's, you're right.
And she said, he said she.
You're right.
Yeah.
He said she.
I thought that was such a good story.
So we did. We hung it over Christy's crib.
Aww.
Yes.
So precious. So precious. Talk about being a mom. What did you like? What was frustrating? What was your greatest joys?
The most frustrating thing was the messes. And I liked everything else.
That's cute.
I loved it. I was born to be a mom. I always wanted to be a mom. I never doubted it, and it's been my greatest joy, except for being married to George for 44 years.
That's awesome. How are the kids alike, and how are they different?
They're both kind. They're both thoughtful. They're both extremely caring. When they were little, Christy was the one who was active, go, go, go. Jordy was more laid back. And now I think they've reversed roles.
Oh, interesting. Yeah. Why do you think that happened?
I don't know. Jordy's true nature is to be, he's extremely active and
so when did they finally each leave home?
When they went to college.
Mm-hmm. And they didn't come back and live after college? Or?
No.
And how did you deal with the empty nest?
It was difficult. I think it was even more difficult when Jordy left because that was final. It was extremely difficult both times, but when the last kid leaves, then you realize you're on your own.
You're done. Yeah. Yeah. So, Christy went on to marry Jack. You want to talk about that?
Oh, that was a dream. That was, we met Jack's mom when we were in Australia, and she talked about Jack and how wonderful he was. And she produced a picture of him, and we thought, well, he's cute. And so George produced a picture of Christy, and we exchanged the photos and brought them home to our kids. And Christy put Jack's picture up on her mirror.
Oh!
And then some months later, we were in Texas at a conference, and Christy met Carolyn. And Carolyn said, well, would you like to go to a military ball in Atlanta? And Christy, that was kind of a dream of hers. And she said, oh, I'd love to go. And George said, well, I'll buy the dress.
Ah!
So Christy, we put her on a plane, and she flew to Atlanta for a 6-day blind date. And we were calling Carolyn and Doug like every night. And
she stayed with them?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And I said, how's it going? And they said, oh, it's cool. They're so cute together.
Oh.
And we just knew this was it. And Christy called us one night and said, well, this is it. And
wow.
We knew it would be.
Wow.
And they've been married since 1998.
Wow.
Jack graduated from the Air Force Academy in 97.
How long did they date before they got married?
Year and a half.
Okay. Awesome. And then Jordy hasn't gotten married yet?
Nope.
But he has a lovely girlfriend.
He has a very special girlfriend, Kristen.
Uh-huh.
Whom we adore.
And how did they meet?
They were is kind of a blind date thing too. Jordy's one of his superiors at his school. His wife works with Kristen and said, well, you guys ought to get together. So they did, and they've been dating almost 2 years.
Wow. And Jordy teaches PE in a private school.
Yep. He's the athletic director at Evergreen Country Day School.
Awesome. Yes. I'm very happy doing that.
Yes.
Nice, nice. So tell us about the other three little joys of your life.
Oh. Ainsley's 13. She's an avid swimmer and avid reader. Lauren is 10 and a half. She loves ice skating and she's extremely creative. Haley is 8 and a half. She loves cheerleading and she's also a great skater, ice skating I'm talking about. And she also loves reading, and they are the joys of our life. It's just awesome to be a grandparent. It's a new adventure and incredible to be able to share your love with new little people.
Tell me about the first time you held Ainsley.
Oh.
I can see it all came back.
Yep. She was born in California because Jack worked at Edwards Air Force Base. So as soon as we heard she was born, we flew out there. And we saw her within 12 hours of her birth. So, and it was just instant love, instant connection.
And she looks a lot like Christy.
She did. She does. Uh-huh. And the other two girls were born in Canada, which is, it's ironic to have that kind of tradition.
Like your brother, yeah.
Yeah. And I was there when both of them were born and stayed to help with all the things that go with a new birth. And it's just incredible to be there.
Now, how do you handle the long-distance grandma role?
We just do. That's just how it's always been, and we just...
What do you do to keep that connection going when you're not there?
We talk, we Skype, we text, and we have them here every summer. They're moving from Florida to Virginia in a couple of months, and it looks like they may be homeless the month of July. And I was talking to Christine Ainsley the other day, and we were brainstorming what they could do. And Ainsley said, well, we could come to Colorado, because she's been here every summer of her life, and she thinks of this as her second home.
All right.
When she was 5, she lived with us for a month while her parents moved from Canada to Florida. And she has her own bedroom here while all the girls have their bedrooms here.
Okay. Do you want to talk about Grandma Camp?
We have Grammy Camp. We have t-shirts every year. Last year they were aqua, and we've had purple, and we've had pink. We need a new color for this year, and we just do fun things, and we are so proud that that's part of their heritage and part of their growing up, coming to Grammy Camp.
And I love that. I love that. What accomplishment are you most proud of?
I think of being married to George for 44 years. It's kind of an accomplishment.
And still in love, and
yes.
Still awesome, and not many people can say that.
Helping him through his 9-month battle, pancreatic cancer, that's a huge accomplishment. Personally, getting a degree in French is probably my greatest personal accomplishment, and doing that at age 66.
And that was a bachelor's?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And how long did that take you?
Let's see, I started in 2006 and graduated in 2014, so 7.5 years.
Nice. You never gave up. Awesome.
I never gave up.
That is awesome. Awesome.
And I got straight A's.
Yay! Who is your biggest fan?
George.
How does he support you?
He's a constant support. He's constantly encouraging. He whatever I wanted to do when I needed to go live in France as part of my degree, he was all for it, even though it meant him living here alone by himself. Although he did take off and go to Europe as part of the time, too, because...
Yeah, it's a long time.
Yep.
That's neat. Who are you a big fan of?
I'm a big fan of George.
And how do you support him?
One of the things I've done to support him recently is in his role as president of NAGC, National Association for Gifted Children. And I've supported him, his desire to take on that role, and through his illness, I've helped him, gone with him to Phoenix for meetings, and I even presented a speech at the Colorado Gifted Association in his place when he had to go to chemotherapy.
And you got a standing ovation.
That was out of my comfort zone.
You did a beautiful job. Just an amazing job.
Oh, we just like to, we've always supported each other and done a lot of things together, like when he taught at Arbeta West, I didn't have a job so that I could be a part of that, and we just like to do things together.
What do you think the secret is of a long, happy marriage?
I think that's a lot of it, and good communication.
What is your definition of happiness?
Being happy with what you have and where you are.
Is there something you wish you could relive again and experience that moment in time again in your life? If you could replay it just to have that memory again?
Yeah, I'll probably go back and live that year in Europe again. It was a dream.
I think that's something a lot of people talk about, but never take that leap of faith and and make that risk and make it happen.
Yeah, it was a risk, and it was... it was a dream, and the things we experienced, the places we went, the countries we went, the people we met and became close to, our landlords in Spain that didn't speak a word of English and took us under their wing as though we were their children, and took us traveling with them.
Seems like that would be a good book. Have you ever thought about?
Yes, I have.
I think that would be an awesome book. With a lot of lessons for a lot of us, you know. What motivates you?
I don't know. It's just inside of me. I don't feel like I need motivation most of the time. I just wake up with it every day.
It's an internal drive.
I wake up happy just about every day, and
what goals are you still working at?
Improving my French. My love of travel still continues, and in 5 weeks we're going to Europe to do a trip that we weren't able to do last summer. And
that's a celebratory trip.
It is. It is.
And where are you going?
Well, we're going to Spain, to a place we discovered on that year when we moved from Belgium to Spain. We drove all night, and I don't remember how we've discovered this tiny village on the Costa Brava, on the Mediterranean, and it's the home of Salvador Dali.
Oh, wow.
And it's just tucked into a little cove on the sea, and we're staying in the same hotel that we stayed in 44 years ago.
Oh, wow.
And then we're going to stay with my dear, dear friend Beatrice and her husband Ivo in the mountains in France. And I've stayed with them a few times before, and they've come here, and that's very special. And then we're going to Aix-en-Provence, where I studied, and just explore around the area of Provence,
oh,
and the villages, and Arles, where Van Gogh lived, and all around. And then we're going to Marseille, and we're coming home.
Oh, wow. Sounds like an amazing trip. When people look back at your life, how do you want to be remembered?
As loving and kind and thoughtful and inspiring. I try to inspire my granddaughters. I call Christy and talk to the girls and say, well, I've been to school today, and I want them to know that learning doesn't stop when you graduate from high school or college.
Mm-hmm.
That I try to be an example for them, that learning continues.
What's your best hope for your own children and your grandchildren?
That they have as rich a life as George and I have had.
Do you have a favorite quote or a motto that inspires you?
I do, but I can't think of it right now. It's by Charlemagne. And I'm sorry, I can't.
If you think of it, we'll add it in.
Okay.
What's your superpower?
I think it's my innate happiness.
Where do you think that comes from?
My mom.
And she was like that?
Yeah. Positive.
Awesome. What is your greatest achievement?
To live this long and this happily.
Awesome. I'm going to give you a minute to think about this one. If you could write a 6-word memoir, what 6 words would you sum up your life with?
I did it the best I could.
I love that. I love that. What, and what message do you want to say for posterity, for Christy and Jordy and Ainsley and Lauren and Haley?
You have been so loved and cherished.
Every moment. Every moment. Every moment. That is a beautiful gift to give. Is there anything else you'd like to add?
No.
Got it? All right. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you, Karen.
Honor.